this is Kenzie, and you're listening to Tink Talk, hosted by my favorite fish guy, John Hudson from KGTropicals.
Thank you, Kenzie. Welcome, folks, to another episode of Tank Talk, presented by KGTropicals, Universal Rocks, and DustinsFishTanks.com. My name is John Hudson. I'll be your host with you for the next hour or so, talking all about the aquarium hobby. This is a show that comes to you every single week to help you take your love of fish keeping to the next level. Today's episode is going to be a lot of fun because we're going to talk all about aquarium maintenance. We're going to talk about the things that you need to do to keep your tank healthy and thriving, keeping your fish happy and healthy. It's more than just walking by the tank every day and going fishy, fishy, and throwing food in there. There's more to it than that, and we're going to get into that today. If you'd like to communicate with this show, you can contact me directly by emailing kgtropicals@gmail.com, or we have a message line set up specifically for this podcast. The number is 1-540-709-1054. You can leave a message on that line, talk about anything you want to talk about, ask questions, topic suggestions. If you want to find out what kind of razor I use on my head, it doesn't matter. I'd love to hear from you. So go ahead and send in your messages now. So let's get right into it. Let's keep this episode action-packed. Let's move right into the announcements and John's World. Okay, before we get started on the topic of the day, I always talk about a few things that we have going on, make some announcements, and then we do John's World. And the last few weeks, I really haven't had any announcements to make because, well, you know, things have been what they've been. So, but today I do have an announcement and I'm excited about it. It's not really going to affect you that are listening to this podcast right now, but hopefully you can understand why I would be excited about this. There are a lot of people out there, folks, that email me and they say, I'm really interested in your podcast. I'd love to be able to listen to it, but I don't know how. Or I don't have access to podcasts or whatever it is. There are people that don't really understand yet what this podcast thing is. They don't understand that it's something that you can get on your phone or your Android or Apple. It doesn't have to be iPhones. There's so many people that believe podcasting is exclusively an iTunes thing. And we all know better than that. So there's been so many people that have said, I'd love to listen to your podcast. I just can't. I just don't know how to do it. Well, I have decided to help those people out by uploading the podcast episodes to YouTube. Now, everybody has access to YouTube. Well, everybody has access to podcasts too. They just might not know it. But the people who are unfamiliar with how podcasting works, or they don't know how to do it, or that there are people that still believe that in order to listen to a podcast, you have to be sitting at your computer, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. These people are now going to be able to listen to our podcast on YouTube. Now, I should have done this a long time ago, but I didn't think it would work. I didn't think that there would be people that would actually listen to an hour long video or click on a video that's an hour long with no video, just listening to it. I didn't think that that would work, but I uploaded the very first episode on Sunday. It was actually part one of my interview with Joey Mullen, and it did very well. I'm very surprised at how many people have actually listened to it. Now, I don't have the numbers yet as far as, you know, did they listen to the entire thing or what? I don't know. But the numbers that are coming in from YouTube already are pretty encouraging, and I'm excited about it. I'm excited that so many people have been able to be exposed to this podcast that maybe weren't able to before. So that's something that's going to be happening every single week with every single episode, but I'm not going to put them up like the same day. You know, I'm uploading this podcast today. I'm not going to upload it to YouTube at the same time. I'm going to actually be uploading podcast or pod vids is what I call them. Maybe that's an actual term. I don't know. I've been calling them pod vids. I'm going to put them up once a week. It's either going to be Thursdays or Fridays. I'm not 100% sure, but it's not going to be the episode that went up that week. For example, this coming week is going to be Joey part two. And then I might go into my episode about building a fish room or, breeding fish or what. I don't know. Who knows? But that's going to be something that's going to go up every single week. And I'm really excited about it again, to be able to give access to people who don't have this whole podcasting thing figured out yet. So I'm excited about that. Now, if we're fast forwarding to the future. And if you're listening to this on YouTube, podcasting is easy. If you want to listen to a podcast through an actual podcast reader, it's very simple to do. It doesn't take long to look into it. If you're an Apple user, a kindergartner could do it. So it's easy to figure out. And I encourage you to do that because there are thousands of podcasts out there. There's podcasts for every single niche. And so there's a whole world of entertainment open to you. I would definitely encourage you to look into that further. So excited about that. I'm excited to be able to put those up on YouTube, and finally excited to be able to have an announcement. So let's move on to John's World.
John's World.
Okay. John's World is something that I struggled with today. I'm going to be honest with you. Usually John's World is something that I come up with on the fly right before I record, because I want to be able to talk about something that's fresh on my mind. Last week, I talked about the Serial podcast, still completely obsessed about it, having a little bit of withdrawals because they didn't put up an episode last week because of Thanksgiving, but excited about this episode coming out. Today, when I sat down to think about what I was going to talk about on John's World, it was hard. I couldn't think of anything because there's not really a whole lot of things going on except for this. Folks, I need to grow this podcast. I need to get this thing out to the masses. And there's only one way that I'm going to be able to do that, and that is going to be through you. Through you sharing this podcast on your Facebook page or on your Twitter or on your Google+ or on your Pinterest or whatever it is, I am going to ask you to do me that favor. If you could share this with your friends. If you go on my actual podcast page, that is tanktalk.libsyn.com, which is LIBSYN.com. There's share buttons right there. You can do all of that. I would really appreciate it because there are ways that you can get word out, like to the masses. I mean, I could put an ad out in one of the magazines, which I think that magazines might not necessarily be the best way to advertise anymore. There's going to shows and conventions and things like that. But the bottom line is I'm working two full-time jobs. We're really fighting to get by. I can't separate myself from the business for, a weekend to go and do a show and all of these kind of things. Plus there's the money involved. Advertising is expensive. So what I have found throughout my whole life is that anything I've ever been involved with, the best way to grow anything is to do it by way of word of mouth. You hope that it would happen naturally, but sometimes you have to ask for it. And sometimes you have to say, hey folks, do me the favor of sharing this, telling your friends about it. If you're going to go to an aquarium club meeting this weekend, tell your friends at that meeting about it. Help me to build this thing up so that people can take me a little bit more seriously. I know that sounds funny, but the podcast is getting a lot of downloads and it's doing very well. I'm really excited about it, but it's still difficult to get anybody to take me seriously. Now, here's the thing. I'm looking for sponsors, folks, and I'm trying to find people that want to partner with this show to help to take their company to the next level, which would in turn make this podcast go to the next level. Everybody's happy. Everybody wins. And sometimes it's difficult to get people to take you seriously because particularly the aquarium industry is kind of living in the Stone Ages when it comes to advertising, and they don't quite get it yet. That advertising is going online. That is what it is. And so the only way to really get through and really get them to grasp that this is a really critical way of advertising is to be able to tell them some mind-blowing numbers. So with your help, I do believe that we can actually make this happen and make this thing grow to bigger and better things. So if you could share it for us, tell your friends about it. Put up your reviews and ratings and things like that on Stitcher, on iTunes. That would be a huge help for us and very much appreciated. So thank you so much for letting me vent about that a little bit. And it is now time to move on. Okay, I've had this podcast for going on 3 months now. And in every single episode, except for the first two, I've been talking about these companies, folks, that are helping us to continue on to do this podcast. We're talking about Universal Rocks. We're talking about Dustin's Fish Tanks. Folks, if you haven't gone on these websites yet, I encourage you to do this. I was speaking to Ben Dunn yesterday from Universal Rocks, and he's been telling me that the orders have been coming in, so that's really cool. We're getting to the busy season. We're getting to the holiday season. You're gonna need to get all of your supplies as well as gifts for your friends or for your spouse. So you're gonna wanna check out these two websites and also check out kgtropicals.com because we've got everything on the planet available on that website by way of Amazon affiliate links. So check out universalrocks.com. When you go on that website, enter Tank Talk in the promo box at checkout. They're gonna give you a 15% discount on your order, completely transform the look of your aquarium. And then there's my friend Dustin from Dustin's Fish Tanks. Also on his website, if you enter Tank Talk, you get a 20% discount on live plants or anything else that's available on his website. You can't lose. Head over to universalrocks.com, dustinsfishtanks.com, and of course, please, kgtropicals.com. Aquarium maintenance might seem like something that's common sense to the advanced fish keeper, but there's a lot of ways of looking at it. There's a lot of different aspects to it that we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about why we maintain our aquariums. We're going to talk about what we use to maintain our aquariums, and then we're going to talk about the different processes and the different checklists that you should use when you're maintaining your aquarium, because we all want to have our aquarium look nice and be healthy and everybody's happy. And that is a beautiful thing. So the first thing that we need to talk about is why we do it. Now, there's more to it than just having the aquarium look nice. There's much more to it. And I like to use the human analogy. I always do this. Whenever we're talking about fish, I like to use human analogies because it makes it make more sense. So let's just say that you have been put into a room with 12 other people, okay? And this is a decent-sized room, sealed off. The light is turned on for about 8 hours a day in this room. Otherwise, it's turned off and everything's quiet. You've got a little bit of air pumped into the room, but not very much. But it's enough air to keep everybody alive. And once or twice a day, some food is thrown into the room. Okay, so I've basically described a fish tank. But imagine this as being human beings. What would happen? Well, in the very beginning, everything would be fine. I mean, everybody would get along. Everybody's new. It's, hey, how you doing? You know, everybody would be peachy. But then after a while, what would happen? Well, you're in this room. I didn't say there was a bathroom in this room. So everybody in the room is just doing their thing wherever they want to because there is no designated bathroom area in this room. So people are just letting it go wherever they have to let it go. And so, of course, the food that's being thrown into the room is sometimes getting mixed and ooh and gross, and the room becomes very unsanitary and it's absolutely reeks, and the air is starting to get thick, and the air that's being pumped into the room is not enough to combat the disgusting funk that is building up in this room. And what's going to happen? People are going to start getting pissed off. People are going to start getting irritable. They're going to start getting angry. Somebody's going to try to take charge, and everybody else is going to revolt against that person, and it's going to get to be absolute anarchy in that room, and people are going to go out of their minds. Why? Because they're in this room that smells horrible. The air is thick. Food is only thrown in every once in a while. The light is only on for 8 hours a day. Everybody's competing for the top position in the room. We're all killing each other. We're all angry and mad. And what ends up happening? People start dying. People start dying from disease because the room is filthy and funky. People start dying from malnutrition. And they might also start dying from aggression, because when you have 12 people in a room and you stick them in there for long enough, they can only stay sane for so long before they start to turn on each other. This is what happens in an aquarium, folks. You set it up and it looks beautiful and it's gorgeous and the water is crystal clear and the fish are happy and everything's wonderful. But exactly what I just said happens in every single aquarium. The fish, they go to the bathroom wherever they happen to be, when the need arises. They get food thrown in every once in a while. A lot of us fish keepers are on schedules, but their casual fish keeper, not aquarist, but fish keeper, is just going to, oh, I forgot to feed the fish. Here we go. And sometimes they might throw more food in than what's necessary, and it sinks down to the bottom, and it gets all mixed up in the fish's waste. And this is what happens. The tank gets disgusting. The water starts getting contaminated because of all of the uneaten food, because of the waste, because of the excess fish that are in there that are constantly expelling this stuff from their bodies. And the water gets nasty. There's food all over. There's waste all over. The same scenario that I described in my little analogy there with human beings. So you can imagine that after some time, after all of this stuff settling in, your fish can get pretty angry. And when they get angry, they start fighting each other. You've already had to move past the whole concept that they're fighting each other in the beginning to take dominance of the tank. But once that settles down and the tank gets disgusting, they start fighting each other because they're just angry, because they're not being taken care of. They're not in a healthy environment, and that just stresses them out and makes them mad. And so they start fighting with each other just because they're mad, and the fish start ended up, they end up dying because they're killing each other. And then you're left with one fish in this disgusting mud puddle that you've allowed to get that way because you haven't done your maintenance. So that's why we're talking about this today, because you don't want that. We could talk about all the scientific reasons with nitrates and nitrites, and we can talk about ammonia, and we can go all scientific, but we don't have to, because when you look at it that way, it's common sense. These fish are swimming around in their own toilets. They're confined to a small area, and when that small area gets full of all of their waste and all of their everything, it can get pretty nasty, and anybody in that situation would get angry, frustrated, bitter, and want to hurt somebody. So that's why we're going to take care of our aquariums. It's more than just adding water when it evaporates. So we need to prevent this from happening by doing some simple maintenance, simple things. We don't have to go overboard. It's not something that takes 8 hours a week for you to take care of one aquarium. It can be done in a very short amount of time, and your tank can be kept very nice, healthy, where your fish are happy and thriving, and it's not going to take you all that long. So that was fun, wasn't it? I had a good time with that. I was swinging my arms around and everything. It was a good time. So let's talk about the things that you're going to need to, you know, the minimum amount of things that you're going to need to maintain your aquarium and to keep it absolutely pristine and keep your fish happy and healthy. The first thing that we're going to need is a way to remove old water from the tank so that it can then be replaced with clean water. So we're going to need a siphon hose. And while we're siphoning out that water from the tank, we want to make sure that we sift through our substrate to get all of the uneaten food and the waste out from the bottom of the tank. And this is going to be accomplished with a vacuum hose that is on the end of your siphon tube. So one of the first things that you need to look for is an aquarium gravel vac siphon hose. They're at every single pet store. They've got them. They're easy to get. You can order them on Amazon. We have them on our website. Very simple. One of the most basic things that a fish keeper needs. Now, if you only have one tank or maybe two, this will work out perfectly fine for you. But if you have multiple tanks, I could not recommend more that you buy one of these water changing systems. It's going to replace your siphon hose and buckets. This is a system that will hook up to your sink. If you have a laundry sink or just a bathroom sink or even the kitchen sink, it'll hook up to your sink and it will use your water pressure from the sink to not only siphon out the old water, but then you can then use the same hose to replenish the water back into the tank. It's very efficient. You can do it with very little mess, if any mess at all. And it's some of the best money that you will ever spend. If you only have one tank and it's a very big tank, I would still recommend to you that you get one of these water changing systems. But if you got a small tank or two, you know, 55 gallons or less, you can get away with just using the standard aquarium siphon, and some 5 gallon buckets. Not a big deal. Easy enough to do. But again, if you've got multiple tanks, then I would definitely recommend either the Python or the Aquion water changing system. Both of these are available on KGTropicals.com. Now, the next thing is a test kit, a water test kit. Now, you can go out and you can buy the little dipsticks that it basically, you dip this little stick, shocker, into the water, and it will tell you what your levels are as far as your ammonia, your nitrite, your nitrate, and your pH. These work pretty well. They're not the most advanced way of testing your water, but if it's all you can afford, that's fine. The best thing that you could do would be to get a master test kit, which is going to test for all of those things. It takes a little bit more time. It's a little bit more involved process, but it's much more accurate, and it gives you that peace of mind to know that everything in your tank is A-okay. And we're only talking about maybe $30 here for the API master test kit. It's not that bad. Again, it sounds like I'm doing a commercial here, but that test kit is also available on KGTropicals.com. Now, the next thing is something to clean the glass. I almost said grass. So many people come into my shop and they say, I need something to clean my tank. I need a algae eater. That's what everybody walks in looking for. Now, there are fish out there like Otto's and Siamese algae eaters and Chinese and plecos and things like that that do graze on algae. And there's some that eat nothing but algae, and they do a great job of that. But you should not depend on these fish to keep your aquarium clean. You're going to need to get in there and do some work. So you're going to need a sponge or something like that. Even if it's one of those magnetic things where you put one end inside the tank and the other end through magnets is on the outside and you just run it back and forth and it cleans off the glass. That's something. Algae is not really going to kill your fish, but it's something that immediately makes your tank look horrible. You're going to want to keep that under control. And to me, the easiest way of doing it is to just buy a sponge from the dollar store that has the little scuffy side on one side and the other side is a sponge. Get your arm down in there. It ain't going to hurt you. The fish aren't going to bite you. I mean, unless you keep, like, you know, big crazy fish, snakeheads and whatever. I mean, there are a lot of fish that will bite you, but okay, we're not talking about that. Put your arm down in there and use the sponge to clean it out. Even some of your more aggressive fish will get scared and they'll run off when your arm is in there. I have definitely been bitten by many fish, and there's only about 3 million videos on YouTube of people getting bitten by fish. And if you have one of those fish, then okay, maybe you should get one of those magnetic things or one of those sponges on the end of a little pole that you can stick down in there so that you can keep from getting bitten, whatever. But most of us are going to keep fish that are not going to want to bite off our hands. And so we're going to just use a sponge and stick it down in there. Costs you like a dollar. I mean, it's dirt cheap. You might as well go that way. I am always a person that says cheaper is better. Now, you're also going to need some extra things that you may not need on every single water change, but these are things that you're definitely going to want to keep in your possession at all times. And that is your new filter media. Now, it's going to depend on what you keep. Now, if you listened to the episodes that Joey and I did together, we talked about all different kinds of filters out there, from sponge filters to hang on the back filters to canisters and sumps. All of them, with the exception of sponge filters, all of them have media inside of them that needs to be maintained. Whether it's a sponge that is on top of your drip plate on your sump, or if it's your cartridges that have carbon in them and a spongy material on one side that slide into your Marineland Penguin 350s, whatever it is, you're going to want to keep those things handy because they are going to need to be replaced after a while. Now, if you're using the most standard filter on the market out there, which would be things like the Whisper series, the Tetra series, the Marineland penguins and emperors. There's an Aquatech version that I think is Aquatech is exclusive to Walmart. There's a lot of different filters out there that use cartridges that are simple. You pull them out, you throw them away, and you put a new one in there. These are the things that you're going to need to keep handy. Keep a box of them underneath your aquarium because you never know when you might need to replace one. Who knows what's going to happen in your tank? You might do some work in there and it stirs a bunch of stuff up and it all gets sucked up into the filter and clogs up your sponges. You don't want that to happen. You want your filter to be running at its peak efficiency all the time. So you're going to want to keep some of those sponges or those cartridges handy. And we're going to talk about more of that as we go. But replacement filter cartridges or media, whatever it is that you're using in there. And then we're also going to need water conditioners. Going to take a minute here to talk about water conditioners because another big misconception is that all water conditioners do is remove chlorine. And that's absolutely not true. There are so many different things that are in these water conditioners. And again, I'm not a scientific person. I'm not going to go all scientific. But there's so much more in these water conditioners than just dechlorinator. There's things that help with slime coat. There's things that help with metabolism. I mean, there's all different kinds of things that are in this in these water conditioners. And so it's not only a dechlorinator, but it's almost like throwing vitamins in the tank at the same time. Maybe not the same type of vitamins that they would get from their food, but you understand what I'm saying. There's much more than just the dechlorinator. So even if you're on a well, or even if you say, my water's perfect that comes out of the tap, it doesn't matter. It's still a good idea to go ahead and put in some of these water conditioners. Now, there are water conditioners out there that contain live bacteria because people believe that when you do a water change, you're removing some of the live bacteria. There's truth to that. And so they like to use these water conditioners like StressZyme that have bacteria in them that will, you know, help to replenish the bacteria that was lost. That's great too. But a water conditioner, like for example, Prime, is my favorite. I believe Prime to be the best water conditioner on the market. I'm sorry, API. I'm sorry, all these other brands, Fluval, but Prime to me is the best. And that's a great thing to have, even if you're on a well. Prime is also good to have in case you ever have a problem that pops up in your tank, like an ammonia spike or something like that. Again, we're going to talk about that as we move forward, but Prime is kind of my water conditioner of choice, but you can have your favorites. A lot of people love Stress Coat. I mean, there's so many different types of water conditioners out there and they all work. So, you know, you may have your preference and stick with what's working, but water conditioners, absolutely critical. Now, I could make this list 50 more items on this list. And there's a lot of people that are thinking, well, when's he going to say this? When's he going to say that? Well, I'm going to keep this list very simple. There are a lot of people that listen to this podcast that are newcomers to the hobby, and they don't want to be overwhelmed with a bunch of stuff that is really more towards the advanced aquarist. So we're going to keep this simple, and that is the list that I'm going to give you of items that you need to have. Even if you have your tank for a year now and some of these items you don't have, you better go get them because I can't believe that you wouldn't have them by now. But if you're a newcomer, these are the things that you're going to need to get. A siphon hose with a gravel vac. You're going to need a test kit. You're going to need somewhere for that water to go when you take it out. So it's either going to be a drain, out the window, or 5-gallon buckets. Or if you have one of those water changing systems, it would go into your sink. You're going to need something to clean the glass and the decor in your tanks, whether that be a sponge on the end of a pole or whatever it is. We're not going to count on our algae eaters. Then we're going to need replacement media for our filters, whatever filter it is that you're using. It's very simple to figure out what that media is. Have some of that on hand in case you need it, and also for routine maintenance. And then we're going to need our water conditioners that we're going to put into the water once our maintenance is done to make sure that water is suitable. The new water is suitable to be put in with our fish. So that's it. That's the minimum amount of stuff that you're going to need. So let's get into the process. Let's talk about what you should be doing every single week. I don't care what kind of fish you keep. It doesn't matter. You're going to need to do these things every single week. Okay, so we're going to talk about maintaining one tank here. Okay, we're not going to go and get into all of these examples of how we can maintain multiple tanks at the same time and all. No, we're going to keep this simple and streamlined, and we're going to talk about maintaining one aquarium. If you have a bunch of them, then you can, you know, just take what I say and multiply it by whatever, however many tanks you have. So there are things that we're going to need to look for, things that we're going to need to do that go beyond just water out, water in. Okay. So one of the first things that people are going to ask me is, how often should I be doing my maintenance? And there's a couple of different answers for that. The first one is, you're going to be doing maintenance every single day. I mean, you're going to be doing maintenance without even looking, because when you walk by your tank, or when you look in your tank, or when you feed your fish, you're going to be checking things instinctively, and you may not even know that you're doing it. Obviously, you're going to be looking at the temperature. I'm sure that you have a thermometer. If you don't, you should have a thermometer somewhere that you can just glance at each day to make sure your temperature is where it's supposed to be. You're going to look at your filter to make sure that that's operating. You're going to make sure that the bubbles are coming out of your air stone. You're making sure that things are where they're supposed to be. The lids are closed. All of these different things, you're going to do this instinctively without even realizing that you're looking at these things. So technically, you're maintaining your aquarium every single day, but it's not necessarily work. You're going to put your work in a minimum of once a week. Now, I'm talking the average home aquarium that has a couple of fish in it, or maybe it's got a bunch of tetras in it or something like that. The average home aquarium, I'm going to recommend to you that you maintain your tank once a week. Now, can some people get away with doing it every other week? Yes, but we're not going to get into all of the different reasons why that's okay sometimes, and sometimes it's not. I am telling you that my opinion is you should be doing this a minimum of once a week. Okay? So that's the first thing. First things first. Now, what are you going to do every single week when you go to do your maintenance? Now, obviously we're going to be doing a water change. When you get into this hobby, and you don't have to be in it for very long before you know, water changes are a thing that's part of the hobby. And if you're not going to do them, don't get into this hobby, because like I said before, that room is going to start stinking. It's going to start filling up with methane, and it's going to be gross. We're going back to my story about the human analogy here, of course, but you have to do water changes. I mean, it's part of the deal. It comes with the hobby. If you don't think it's something that you're going to like doing, then don't buy a fish tank. Okay? So water changes, yes, that is a big part of it, but there is other stuff to look at. The first thing that I'm going to want you to do, obviously, and again, you're going to do this every day, but you're going to want to inspect the overall health of the aquarium. You're going to want to make sure that there's no oddities going on in your tank. What do I mean by that? Big white spots on your fish, or fish behaving in a way that you know is not normal. You might have a disease in that tank, and if there is a disease in that tank, your maintenance is going to be a little bit different than it would be if everything was normal. We're not talking about problems in the fish tank today. We're talking about routine maintenance. So I'm not going to get into all of that stuff. But the first thing you're going to want to do is an overall visual inspection of the whole deal, including looking around the tank to make sure that you don't have any leaks. I know that sounds like common sense, and I know you feel like if an aquarium leaks, it's going to be huge and all of a sudden your house is going to be flooded, but it's not always that way, folks. You can have a very small leak that's leaking behind your aquarium, and it's leaking at such a slow pace that you write it off as evaporation, but it's not. It's actually a very small pinhole leak in the bottom of your filter that's leaking drip by drip by drip right onto your floor that's behind your aquarium, and you don't realize it until your floor rots out and your tank ends up in your basement or your crawl space. I've heard of this happening before, folks. So you need to do an overall visual inspection to make sure that you don't have any leaks. You think that you're going to be doing this instinctively, but you're not. I want you to actually make a concerted effort to look behind your tank, look on top, look underneath, look everywhere to make sure that you don't have any leaks. You have the, I don't have data on this, but I'm just going to go ahead and guess that the average home aquarium for the average fish keeper, not the advanced aquarist, but the average fish keeper, is probably 20 gallons. Okay. And 20 gallons when it's confined in this little box doesn't seem like a lot, but it's going to seem like a ton of water if it ends up on your floor. So you're going to want to check for these leaks. Little pinhole leaks, if they're in the tank, they can actually lead to disaster. That is like a warning sign. You have a pinhole leak. It's time to react. Don't dilly-dally. You need to get in there and fix this problem or replace the tank before it really does become a problem. Because trust me, you don't want to see what 20 gallons of water looks like on your living room floor. Okay? So, checking for leaks. Check around the back. You also, one of the things that a lot of people might just look past and not even consider is that you have moving water in your filter. I don't care what kind of filter you use. I mean, this is not usually a problem with canister filters because the only parts that are exposed are the input and the output. But if you have a hang on the back filter or things like that, or sponge filters, you have moving water that's going through it. And sometimes there can be something in the filter that's causing just a little spritz of water to shoot out of the filter. I see it happen all the time. And there's little drips of water that are going down to the floor that down the road can lead to a huge problem if you don't fix that. So an overall visual inspection to make sure that there's no leaks, that there's no water spewing out onto the floor. Oh, and by the way, sponge filters, I mean, you might be thinking there's no moving water. The reason why I brought up sponge filters is because one of the things that a lot of people do, and I've even been guilty of this myself, is they turn the air up too much on sponge filters. And so what happens is the bubbles that are coming out of that sponge filter are coming at such a rapid rate that it's splashing water out of your aquarium. And so that's why I said that sponge filters can cause, not necessarily leaks, but they can cause water to be removed from your tank and you don't even know it. If it's going out of the back, you don't know it until, you know, all of a sudden your tank is in the basement. So make sure there is water only in places where it's supposed to be, and then you should be safe. We're going to want to do a visual inspection on the tank, making sure that the seals seem to be okay. None of us are glass experts, but you'll be able to notice if there's something wrong with one of the seals in one of the corners or something like that. Just a quick visual inspection of what is going on in your tank and making sure that things are where they're supposed to be. Another thing that a lot of people neglect to look for, and it's easy to have this happen, is light cords going into the water. This is a big deal, okay? Not all of these light fixtures are meant for their cord to be underneath the water. In fact, they are absolutely not meant to be that way. And so one of the things that people miss on sometimes is that the water, there's water sitting somewhere and your power cord goes through it. And this can mean disaster, folks. So you need to make sure that that's not going on. Again, this is going a little crazy here, but there's sometimes people have so much movement in their aquarium that what ends up happening is water splashes up onto the top of their lids. And so you've got a little puddle of water on top of your tank. You don't even know it's there and your power cord for your light is going right through it. So now this is mostly for some of your older style fluorescent, the black box style lights that you have on your aquarium. Most people now are going to LEDs, and one of the beautiful things about LEDs is that the power cord is on the very end of almost all of them, and so that makes this problem kind of moot. But the older fluorescent lights, a lot of them, the power cord went right into the middle of the light, which was dumb. I mean, why wouldn't they put it on the end? But that's what they did, and so you need to be cognizant of the power cord. So you're doing a visual inspection and you're making sure everything's okay. Now, I'm going into all of this detail and I'm telling you all of the things that you need to look for. But in reality, folks, this inspection is going to take you 30 seconds. Okay, I'm not telling you to go through with a magnifying glass and a flashlight to check every single square inch. No, it's a quick visual inspection of the whole thing, making sure that water is only inside the tank. Now, the next thing is, once we know everything's in where it's supposed to be, the water is where it's supposed to be, now we need to check our equipment. We need to open up your filter. If it's a hang on the back filter, I'm not recommending that you open up your canister filter every time you do a water change, but if you have a hang on the back filter, open it up, see what's going on in there, see how the water is flowing. And if you have one of the filters, you have a larger tank and you have one of the Marine Lands or the Tetras or the Whispers or whatever that have two cartridges, you want to look at both of them. And what I tell everybody is get in the habit of replacing those cartridges at least once a month. So what this means, what I want you to do, I don't want you to replace both of those cartridges at the same time. Your filter is the main place. It is the cesspool of bacteria that grows in your tank. The good kind, the kind of bacteria that we want that Joey talked so much about last week. We want that bacteria in there. When you remove one of those cartridges, one of the sponges, you're removing a lot of that bacteria. And so we don't want to put too much of a shock on the tank by removing all of this beautiful bacteria that's in our filter. So change one at a time. What I say to do is to change one every other week. So when you do your maintenance this week, you change the one that's on the left. And then 2 weeks from now, you'll change the cartridge that's on the right. That's the easiest way to do it. This way, they're being replaced once a month, and everything should work perfectly fine with that. Now, when you do your visual inspection on your filter, let's say you're between weeks of replacing the filter cartridge. When you do your visual inspection, one of the things that you might see is the filter cartridge itself, the blue sponge, some of them are white, but the sponge is all caked with brown blech all over it. And what's happening is the water is no longer going through the sponge. Instead, it's flowing over the top of it. Now, your filter has to be nasty for this to happen, but I see it all the time. In my own tanks, I've seen it. Not the ones at home, but the ones at the shop sometimes, they can, you know, it is what it is. But what the water will do is flow over top of your cartridge, making it completely useless. It's not doing anything. And so you want to do a visual inspection on that. If you have a highly populated tank, if you're an African cichlid keeper and you have 40 fish in the tank, you're going to want to definitely take a look at that, because that filter's job is to suck up all of that poop and suck up those uneaten flakes and crumbs of food and suck them up into it, and it gets caught in that sponge. If that sponge gets full and completely caked, then it's no longer going to be efficient. Now, if you want to get a little extra life out of your cartridges, there is a way to do it and there's a way not to do it. What I want you to do, let's say you get in the routine of cleaning your filter cartridges every single week. You can do this, but there's a right way and a wrong way. First thing I want you to do is take one of your 5 gallon buckets and fill it full of water from your aquarium, not from the sink. I don't want you to take your filter cartridges to your kitchen sink and rinse them under the sink. No, we want water from your aquarium, siphon it out, put it into a 5 gallon bucket. You only need maybe 6 inches or so. Take your cartridges out and swish them around in that water. Run your hand over it to get all of that poop and food off of the sponge, and then put them back in. And then what's happening is you're saving your sponge a little bit. When you do that, you're getting a little bit more life out of your sponge, but then your cartridge is still going to need to be replaced as we move forward, because the carbon that is inside of that is no longer going to be affected. Now, there's people out there that believe that carbon is useless, and for them, they'll get a lot longer life out of their filter cartridges. But for the average fish keeper, if you do rinse this off the way I'm talking about, you will get a little bit more life out of the sponge, but it's not going to give you more life out of the carbon. And when I say carbon, if you take that filter cartridge and you shake it, you can hear something rattling around in there. They're little teeny chips of carbon. And that's one of the things that's going to help your water to stay clear and stop it from being stinky and all of that kind of stuff. So you get a little bit more life out of the sponge, but you will not get any more out of your carbon. So you're looking at your filter. If you're seeing the water go over the top, kind of cascade over top of the filter cartridge, then it's not doing its job. And I would definitely say that you should replace one and rinse the other. If you only have one, then it might be time to go ahead and replace it. Now, on the topic of marine land filters, one of the best hang on the back filters, in my opinion, is the Penguin series as well as the Emperor series. These are filters that both have the bio wheel, which looks like a mill wheel. What are those things called? Paddle wheel, like a paddle boat. It looks like the thing on the back of a paddle boat. That is something that I don't want you to touch it. That is not something that you are going to rinse off. It is not part of the filter. It does not filter your water. That wheel, the only purpose for that wheel is to provide an area for beneficial bacteria growth. So that is not something that you're going to want to include in your routine maintenance. Leave that wheel alone, but you want to make sure that it's spinning. And that's another thing that if your cartridges are clogged, one of the things that is a good sign of that, like a good symptom that you will visually see, is the wheel will no longer be spinning because there's not enough current coming out of that side to get that wheel to spin. So that's another sign that you might need to clean out your cartridges. But that's what you're going to need to do as far as your filter goes. Now, some people like to actually clean the filter out. This is something I encourage people not to do. Because again, you've got all of that beautiful bacteria growing in your filter. The only way that I would say that somebody should clean a hang on the back of filter out is if you're not doing your maintenance, if you're not replacing your filter cartridges and you're not rinsing them out periodically, then you might need to go ahead and clean out the box because it's just so funky that it's gross. Then you may need to, but removing the filter box itself, if you have a hang on the back filter, and actually cleaning the interior of that box out is something that you should not have to do if your filter is maintained. Now, taking that filter box off of the tank and just dumping the contents out, that's fine because a lot of the nasty stuff will settle down at the bottom. Nothing wrong with that. But to actually get in there with a sponge and clean it all out and rinse it and make sure it's spick and span, no, I wouldn't do it. I wouldn't do it at all. That's just my opinion. People may disagree, and that's fine. We can still be friends and disagree. So that's what I want you to do with your filter. Now, once you've done that, then a couple of other quick things to check. Your heater, your air pump, common sense, is the water warm? The heater's working. If the water's cold, your heater ain't working. You need to address that. Air pump, make sure there's no kinks in your hose and things like that. If your filter is strong and it's moving your water, then your air pump isn't going to be absolutely 100% critical to the life of your fish. But air circulation and water agitation and things like that is definitely a good thing to have. So I encourage everybody to have an air pump in their tank. So if you do, make sure there's no kinks or anything like that in the air hose and that the air is flowing through there properly. Air stones do get clogged up, folks, and you're going to need to check those to make sure that the bubbles are coming out nicely or they're coming out of your skull's mouth or your alligator's mouth or whatever it is. So just a quick visual inspection of those things. And once we see that the filter is operating properly, the air pump and the heater is operating properly, your light's not going through the water and all of that kind of stuff, now it's time to get inside the tank and do what we got to do. So now we know that everything's operating properly. We know everything's working. We're all good to go there. Now we need to actually do our water change. Now, it doesn't matter to me how you're removing the water out of there as far as what you're draining it into. If you're doing it into buckets or if you're draining it into the bathtub or out the window, whatever it is, it doesn't matter. The process is always going to be the same. We are going to want to not just remove water. We want to clean the substrate. In that substrate, whether it be gravel or sand or it doesn't matter what, things are going to accumulate down there. It's going to be the uneaten food. It's going to be the poop from the fish. It's going to be anything that's in that water is going to settle down in the gravel. Most aquariums have gravel. And so gravel, in my opinion, is the easiest to maintain, except for maybe a bare bottom tank. But gravel is very simple to maintain. It hides the waste and the uneaten food very well. And the fish are still able to pick through it and it works out good. But we definitely want to make sure that we are cleaning that out. The whole reason why we're maintaining our aquarium is to remove toxins from the water. Those toxins come from waste and uneaten food, and most of that waste and uneaten food is down in that gravel. So if you're half you-know-whatting this, and you're only removing water, you're not doing it right. You're actually not even helping at all. So you need to make sure that you're vacuuming out your gravel. Now, there's most people, when they get into this hobby, they start out with over-the-top decorations in their tank. They want it to be the most beautiful thing in the world, and they decorate with all of these rocks and plants and skulls and pirate ships, and they go completely crazy. There's nothing wrong with that. What I would recommend to you, though, is maybe every other water change, you need to move those things around and make sure that you vacuum the gravel around those things and underneath those things. Because the way water current works, that water is moving through the gravel, which is why the poop and the food is sucked down there. It's not sucked down there. It settles. But you know what I'm saying. Water flows through your gravel. And what it ends up doing is it blows all of this poop and this food, little teeny tiny pieces of it, all blow over, and they congregate underneath all of your decor. So what happens is when you move one of those things and you vacuum it, it's like, oh my God, look at this brown pudding that's being sucked up from underneath it. It is a place for a vast accumulation of waste and food. So vacuuming underneath and in between your decorations is very important. And the best case scenario would be that you would do this on every single maintenance. Every time you do a water change, you're moving these things around and you're vacuuming underneath them. Because everywhere where you forget to do, or everywhere where you get lazy and neglect to do, is a place where you're just leaving this pile of poop sitting there for these fish to breathe and to contaminate the water. So move your decorations around, move things around. This is why you see my tanks are so, there's nothing. They're just kind of wide open wastelands, because I don't like moving all that stuff around. I love aquarium maintenance. That doesn't bother me at all. But to get in there and move 50 rocks around and move the plants and have to reset everything, and I just don't want to do it. And plus, I like to use the fish as decor instead of, you know what I'm saying. So to me, a background and maybe a rock or two is really all I need. Universal Rocks, 15% off. Hey, I had to get that in there. So that's me. That's the way I like to decorate. But if you are someone who likes to have an elaborate decor and these rock formations and plants and all of that, good for you. I'm glad you like that. Make sure that you clean underneath and around those things, because like I said, that is a big, big dump of an area where your fish's dump gets stuck underneath there. So move those around and make sure that you clean under there real good. Now, if you have a 55-gallon aquarium, the gravel vac should not take you literally more than 5 minutes. I mean, you've got maybe, what, a half of an inch of gravel in the bottom of your tank, and the tank's only 4 feet wide. You're just moving your stuff around. You're sucking all of the gravel up into your vac. It's swirling around. All of the brown nastiness is going through the hose, and the gravel is settling back down to the ground or to the bottom of your tank. This, to go through the entire tank, shouldn't take you more than 5 minutes. And then once that's done, you leave your hose in there and let it continue to drain until 30 to 50% of the water has been removed. Now, how much of this you do is going to completely depend on the amount of fish that you have in the tank. If you have a 20-gallon tank and you just have some tetras and a couple of guppies in there, then most likely, by the time you're done vacuuming out your gravel, you've removed enough of the water. Maybe 25%. Nothing wrong with that. If you've got a few tetras and a few guppies in your tank and you're doing a 25% water change every single week, you're good. You're doing exactly what you should be doing. But if you're an African cichlid keeper like me, I've got a 75-gallon tank sitting behind me that has, I think, 19 fish in it right now. And some of them are getting 3.5 inches. They're big poopers and they're big eaters. So I do 50% every single time I do a water change, and I do that once a week. And to be honest, they're getting so big, that's getting to a point where it's not enough. So how much water you remove is going to be dependent on the amount of fish that you have in your tank. It's also going to be dependent on how much you feed your fish. If you're someone who you only want to do 25% water change and you only want to do it once every other week, then I would tell you to feed your fish less, because the more you feed your fish, the more they're going to poop. The more they poop, the more it contaminates the water. So you're actually going to keep your water cleaner by feeding your fish less. Now, is it the right thing to do? I mean, fish can go a couple days and they're okay. Most of them, you know, you're not going to start seeing the sunken bellies and stuff like that if you miss a day of feeding your fish. But I'm a firm believer. I've been the firm believer for 22 years now that I feed my fish a minimum of once a day. If it was up to me, I'd be feeding them twice a day. But in this tank in my studio, if I was to feed these 19 fish twice a day, I'd be doing 50% water changes twice a week, because these fish are getting big. My angel tank, I got a lot of fish in there. You may have seen it already. I'm sitting here looking in it right now. I don't know how many fish there are in here, but there's probably 24 fish in here. It's a 65-gallon tank. Now, most of the fish are very small. You know, I've got inch cardinal tetras. I've got 1-inch German blue rams. And my biggest angel is maybe the size of a 50-cent piece. So they're not huge. I can get away with doing 30% or so once a week, and I'm completely fine. But I'm doing a 30% water change. I'm thoroughly vacuuming out the gravel. I don't need to worry about moving decorations around and stuff like that, because all I have in there is one big beautiful piece of driftwood. So I don't have to worry about all that. It's something that's very simple and very easy. And I clean it thoroughly every single week. So they're doing fine. Once they get grown, the cardinal tetras are never going to be huge, and neither are the rams, but the angels will get really big, and they're going to get big to a point where I'm probably going to have to take a few of them out and put them somewhere else. But when they get big and everybody's full grown, I'm going to be needing to do more water changes, because the bigger the fish, the more they're going to contaminate the water. So it all depends on what you do, or how many fish you have, and how often you feed them. Now, if you want kind of a standard, then 30% once a week would be a standard. I didn't read that in a book. That's just what I'm telling you. But if you have a heavily stocked tank, 50% once a week, it's not going to take you more than another 2 minutes to drain out that extra 20%. Not a big deal. So, okay. So we have thoroughly vacuumed our gravel. We've made sure everything's working properly. And oh yeah, I forgot. You... Stupid me. Maybe I should splice this in down, add it to it. But you definitely are going to want to unplug your filter while you're doing all of this. I should have said this in the beginning, but when you do this, once you have checked to make sure that your filter is operating properly and everything is going the way it's supposed to, you want to unplug it. And main reason why is because when you drain your water out, it can get down to a certain level where the motor is not powerful enough to draw the water up into it. And it needs the water to be at a certain level to be able to do that. I don't understand the physics behind it. I just sell fish for a living. So I don't know why that happens, but when it gets down to a certain level, it will stop having enough power to draw the water into it, and you'll burn your motor up. So just unplug it. Also, another thing to look for is your heater. If you have your heater, a submersible heater, which most of us use, and it's, when you drain your water down, half of the heater gets exposed. You need to make sure that you push that heater down, because if it's a glass heater, once you introduce new water, that's probably a different temperature from the water that you already have, and your heater has been sitting, half of it's been sitting exposed to the elements and has gotten dry and cooled off, you can blow your heater up in a heartbeat. So you need to make sure that that heater stays fully submerged, and you need to make sure that you unplug your filter. It's not necessary to unplug the heater unless you feel weird about putting your hands in a tank that has an electrical device in it. I get it. I understand it. Unplug it and just play it safe. It's no big deal. Okay. So now we're sitting here. We have our filter unplugged. We have our water drained halfway down. We've done a great job vacuuming everything out. What's next? Well, it's very simple. Put your water in. Now, this is where a lot of people ask a lot of questions. What's the right way and the wrong way to do it? Because some people say you should absolutely have your water in some type of vessel that you're going to be using to put back into your tank. And this water is something that you took from your sink yesterday, and you put your water conditioners in that vessel, and you got it all up to temperature. You have a heater in there, or maybe you're just letting it get to room temperature, whatever it is. And it's been sitting for 24 hours, allowing the dechlorinators to do their jobs and la, 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 la. And that is the only way you should put water back into your aquarium. And I'm telling you that I disagree. Is that a good thing to do? Sure. If you have the ability to do that and you have the commitment to this hobby to do that, do it. That's great. You're sitting your water there. You're getting it to room temperature. You're dechlorinating it. You're getting it treated properly to have less of an impact on the fish when you put it in. That's a great idea if you can do it. I don't do it that way. And I don't do it that way because I have 220 tanks at the shop and I've only got three here, but I don't do it that way. And I've never done it that way. Instead, I use a hose. Now, for me, right now, the only thing I have access to in the basement in my studio is a garden hose. So I literally take a garden hose from a cold water hose bib outside of my house and run the garden hose through the basement into the tanks and pump it straight in. Now, you might think that that's really cruel to put cold water into a tank, and I'm telling you that it's not. I've not done an experiment. Perhaps I should. I'm sure someone has. Where if you have a tank that's 80 degrees and you drain out half of it and then you replace the 50% of the water with water that's 65 degrees, the impact that that's going to have on the overall temperature. I'm not sure what that is, but it will certainly lower the temperature of your water. Now, that's a good thing if you're breeding, because it's that cool down that really gets your fish in the mood. And so that can be a good thing if you're trying to breed fish. But what I have found doing it this way for 20 something years is that it does not impact the fish the way that you think it does. So for me, I just run it straight from the hose into there. Now, if you're someone who's using a Python or an Aquion system, then you can get your water to a pretty close temperature right there out of your hose because it's connected to your sink, which has a hot and cold water control. That's perfect. And then you can get your temperature as close as possible to what was already in your tank. And this way you're not altering the temperature in any way. But all I'm telling you is right now I do what I can do. Otherwise I'd be carrying 5 gallon buckets up and down the stairs 150 times to do 50% water changes in 215 gallons worth of water. I ain't going to do it. So I do it from the hose, and I've never lost a fish due to stress after doing a water change. So, and when I do it this way, I put the hose in the tank, I turn it on, the water's flowing in, and that's when I dump in my water conditioners. And I kind of dump it in the stream of the water that's coming in from the hose so that it kind of immediately circulates it through the tank. And I've never had a problem doing it that way. You're going to want to do it the same way if you're using a water changing system. Now, if you're using buckets, and if you have the ability, you have the extra buckets, and you want to let your water sit overnight, there's nothing wrong with that. But if you have a 55 gallon tank and you're doing a 50% water change, you're going to have 5 or 6 of those buckets sitting there overnight. So if you can do it, if you have a place to store the buckets and you have the money to go buy them all, then do it. More power to you. Most of us don't. Most of us are going to look for an easier way to do it. If you run a hose to the tank, your fish will be perfectly fine I promise. Just make sure that when you do this, you make an attempt to get the water at a close temperature. If it's not, don't put frozen water in there. I mean, you know, you don't want to freeze your fish, but if there's a 10 degree, 15 degree difference of the water that you're putting in versus the water that you took out, it's not going to kill your fish in most situations. I'm sure there are some fish that are, you know, particularly fragile that might be a problem for, but I've never seen one of those. I've done water changes exactly the way we're talking about right now with discus, which everybody's afraid of discus, and I never lost one. So, you know, it's completely fine to do it that way. But either way, get your water back into the tank, back up to the appropriate level. What I like to do is I like to fill the water in my tanks just above the bottom of the black or the wood grain trim that runs around the top of your tank. I don't want the top of the water line to be visible. I want that to be above that frame, but I don't want it to go too high that it's splashing out of the tank. So that's what I fill it up to. I put my water conditioners in there. I plug my filter back in and we're done. Except we do want to make sure that everything's running properly again. Of course, you already inspected your filter, but now that you've done your maintenance and you've plugged it back in, you want to make sure that your filter's running properly. And you might need to take a cup of water or something like that and pour it into the box of your filter if it has run completely dry, because it might not have enough power to bring all that water back up into it. So that's it. That's really all you're going to need to do every single week. And then, oh, stupid me again. Whatever. I forgot. Okay. Cleaning the glass. That's another thing that we forgot about. And what I do is I clean the glass prior to doing anything else. And this is why I feel like an idiot for not bringing it up before. When I go in there with my sponge, I usually do it right after I'm done with my gravel vac. Because what happens is you vacuum out the gravel and then you have your hose just sitting there in the water, still drawing water out of it, still draining water out of the tank. That's when I go through and I clean everything off with my sponge. And the reason why I do it that way is because if your water is particularly funky, not your water, but your tank, you got a lot of brown algae, green algae, whatever. When you clean it off of the glass, a lot of times it can stir things up. And so when it stirs things up, it'll suck it right up into that tube and on out of the tank. And so that's when I like to do it, is while the tank is draining after the gravel vac is when I will clean things off with the sponge. And it's really, there's no technique to it whatsoever. That's why I forgot about it, because it's as simple as just take your sponge and run it across the glass. Most algae will just wipe right off with very minimal effort. I would definitely recommend to you to make sure that you clean, you address your silicone that's in the corners, because algae can stain your silicone down the road. And so you want to make sure that you prevent that by keeping your silicone nice and clean, because there's nothing worse than a brown poop stripe going straight down the corner of your tanks. It looks pretty bad. So that's it. I mean, that's as simple as it gets. That is your basic aquarium maintenance, things that you're going to need to do. Like I said, I want you to do this every single week, regardless. I don't care if you're keeping a betta. I want you to do maintenance in that tank every single week. It's the right thing to do to keep your conditions absolutely pristine for your fish. And that's the goal here, right? I mean, we're not doing this for, you know, any kind of social status. We're not doing this to impress anybody. We're doing this for the love of the animals and wanting to keep the animals happy. And so, and not only happy, but healthy. And so to do that, we're going to want to make sure that we keep their water clean. We keep it pretty at the same time, and we keep everything functioning properly. If you do this, your fish will absolutely reward you. So I hope we didn't go too far back to the basics here with you today, but this is an episode that a lot of people asked for, talking about aquarium maintenance. And so that's that. I would like to be able to tell you what next week's episode is going to be about, but I don't know what it is. So I'm not going to be able to do that. But I appreciate you very much listening to this episode today. Please don't forget to support our sponsors, UniversalRocks.com. Enter in Tank Talk at checkout. You get a 15% discount. They have some of the most incredible products you've ever seen. Dustin's FishTanks.com. He's going to give you 20% off if you put in Tank Talk at checkout. And then, of course, there is my website, kgtropicals.com. We got everything the fish keeper's looking for. Definitely check that out. I thank you so much for the support. Thank you so much for listening. And I look forward to talking to you next week.